Good morning. Thanks for tuning in to 1140 KSOO. This is Radio Good News. This program has the goal of proclaiming the love of God to all the world. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those come out of having that saving relationship with Jesus Christ, and they're key to this program. I will focus on God's love because you should never underestimate the redemptive power of God's love. My name is John Thornton. I'm your host for the next 30 minutes. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that's God's word to us in our language. If you have any questions, comments, or concerns you want to talk to me about, write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota, 57101. We'll start off this program with a reading from God's word from Psalm 25, verses 1 through 15. Psalm 25, God's word, 1 through 15. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Do not let those who wait for you be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in the truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me, for your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right, and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep his covenant and his decrees. For your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my guilt, for it is great. Who are they that fear the Lord? He will teach them the way that they should choose. They will abide in prosperity, and their children shall possess the land. The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes his covenant known to them. My eyes are ever toward the Lord, for he will pluck my feet out of the net. Those are God's words from Psalm 25, verses 1 through 15. The Bible tells us to sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, a wide variety of music. And this morning, our first musical guest will be a traditional hymn, one that's listed as the top 25 favorite hymns of America.
Jesus that loves us all.
That's a traditional hymn that's listed as one of the top 25 favorite hymns of America. We'll have a different musician at the end of the program. If you could turn with me for our scripture lesson today to Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. We'll be starting a little bit of a series on parables, the parables as told by Jesus Christ. Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law, and what do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay whatever more you spend.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hand of robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Those are God's words from Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. That's commonly known as the parable of the Good Samaritan. Helen and Olive were 2 old widow women, and they were just sitting around talking about their grandchildren. Helen said to Olive, "Oh, I never know what to do when my grandchildren come over. They are always so energetic and excited. All I found I'm able to do is plop them down in front of the television." Olive asked, "What do you try to do with the children?" "Well, I tried playing tag with them, but I can't run. I tried to play a computer game with them, but I couldn't understand it. I also tried to play catch, but my hands are too twisted to catch the ball. I guess I really have nothing left to give to my grandchildren," responded Helen. "I cannot do any of those things either, but my grandchildren are always begging their mom to bring her over to see me," Olive said. "What in the world do you do?" Helen asked in disbelief. "I tell them stories from my life, and they tell me their stories. We each listen to the other, and those are the very best times of my week." We know that Jesus was a master storyteller. He told wonderful stories that caught and held the attention of his listeners. And thanks to God's protection and provision for us through the Bible, we can still learn from the stories that Jesus told. Let's start our examination of this parable by understanding parables in general. Now, parables are a specific style of storytelling where Jesus is teaching to make his listeners understand a point. And there are differences of opinion on how to understand the parables. Some Bible scholars believe that a parable can make just one point and have just one single solitary message. But I believe that understanding is too limited. And you know, it doesn't really fit how Jesus himself interpreted the parables. Other Bible scholars are on the other extreme, and they've said that each and every little item in a parable, no matter how incidental or trivial, it must be somehow decoded because it all contains a deep, mysterious, and symbolic meaning. Well, I believe that that view is also incorrect, as it just involves wild speculations. Parables. parables usually have one, two, or three main characters. For a proper interpretation of the parables, I believe Jesus intends us to learn a lesson from each of the main characters. In our passage today, we have three main characters. They are the wounded man, the passers-by, and the Samaritan. And each of these main characters will teach us an important point regarding how God wants his people to live and to operate in their lives. The Good Samaritan parable is probably one of the most commonly known parables. Jesus tells this parable as an answer to the tricky questions of a lawyer. And a lawyer in his day was a religious legal expert. So the religious legal expert asked Jesus, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" This is a trick question. And Jesus turns the tables on the religious legal expert. Jesus asks him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" Well, the religious legal expert, he knows his Old Testament. So he responds and he quotes from Deuteronomy 6:5, which says, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind." And then the legal expert also adds a quote from the end of Leviticus 19:18, which reads, "Love your neighbors as yourselves." Jesus, he affirms the answer and he says to the lawyer, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you shall live." But you know, the religious legal expert, he doesn't want to love. He still wants to trick Jesus. So he asks another question. "Just who is my neighbor?" Do you see what this guy's doing? Do you see how he's really trying to find a loophole in God's commandment to love? This is very much like what some people try to do today. But Jesus makes his command very simple. He tells us in John 15:12, "Love one another as I have loved you." Love. That's the command. Love each other as Jesus has loved. It's really a straightforward command. But this religious legal expert wants to find a way to kind of weasel out of his duty. So he asks Jesus, "Just who is my neighbor?" Jesus responds with the parable. A man is traveling on the road and he gets attacked, beaten, and robbed. He's really in dire need. This man in the ditch demonstrates a severe need for assistance. This man, I believe, represents all of us. Jesus does not tell us any details about the man's background, history, or story. He's just a common person, just like any one of us. For in one way or another, someday, each and every one of us will need assistance of somebody else. You know, we may even be in the position where we need the assistance of a total stranger. So in the parable, along comes a priest, a professional clergyman. He's coming down the road. Now, a priest is supposed to be a person who represents God. Now, the religious legal expert probably expected the priest to be the hero of the story, but he's not. When the priest saw the man in the ditch, he passed by on the other side. Now, we can really only speculate on why the priest ignored the man in need. Perhaps he was just too busy doing the work of the temple. Perhaps he just did not want to become ceremonially unclean. Well, whatever his motives, he was wrong to ignore the man in need. He demonstrates a corrupt and evil heart, even though he's a priest. Jesus seems to be telling us that this man represents a group of people by his actions. And this corrupt priest demonstrates that his group of people really only think about themselves, and they don't care about the needy. They were corrupt. The great preacher Charles Spurgeon has commented about the dangers of a group, a church, which has abandoned God's call, a corrupt church. Charles Spurgeon said, "An unholy church, it is of no use to the world and of no esteem among men. It is an abomination. Hell's laughter, heaven's abhorrence. The worst evils that have ever come upon the world have been brought upon her by an unholy church." Those are pretty harsh words from Charles Spurgeon. And yes, the priest was wrong and evil to ignore the needs of the man in the ditch. And a true Christian person would get down into the ditch and help the needy. So along comes a Levite, another passerby. Now in Jesus' day, the Levite were another kind of people, religious workers. They too had the duty to represent God to the people, but again, Jesus chooses to make the villain of the parable a religious guy. So what were the motives of the Levite? Well, again, we can just speculate. But perhaps, just perhaps he doesn't want to help those kinds of people. The Levite didn't want to help those kinds of people. Perhaps he just blames the victim. This could be why the Levite does not assist the man in the ditch. Perhaps he thought that the man in the ditch was somehow deserving of the beating. After all, if he got beaten up, maybe he must have done something wrong and deserved it. So often we see examples of victims getting blamed. And it's not just Levites who blame victims. Today, there are people in our country who blame the victims. There are even religious groups who blame the victims of diseases. There are some groups that say things like, "Oh, if you just had enough faith, your disease would be healed." Other victims get blamed today, too. People who have a different skin color. Some people say, "Oh, they deserve oppression." Or foreigners deserve to live in poverty. You know, it really was a good thing that Egypt did not close her borders down when those dirty refugees from Bethlehem came looking for safety. And you know, other people blame unwed mothers who are on public assistance. Or they blame people trapped in habitual lifestyles, habitual sins. Some say things like, "Alcoholics deserve liver disease." Or, "Smokers deserve lung cancer." Or, "Homosexuals deserve AIDS." But you know, those kind of comments are evil. For while we do know that the wages of sin is death, it's God that judges, not us. Our role is to comfort the afflicted in love. I personally have been at the bedside when many, many people died of horrible diseases. And some of the diseases, I admit, were a direct result of the person's behavior. But no one deserves to die a horrible, horrible death. Even though sin does have its consequences, true Christians will have compassion on every person, even if their sinful behavior did lead to their affliction. For each and every one of us have committed sins that have damaged our own lives, and each and every one of us will be in need of help sometime. We cannot castigate others, attempting to build ourselves up. A true Christian person will get down into the ditch and help the needy in mercy and in love. For we all must remember and live out what God taught us in 1 John 4:20 through 21. There we read, "Those who say, 'I love God,' and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And this commandment we have from God, that those who love God should love their brothers and sisters also." Yes. When people in need are ignored or blamed for their problems, it's an act of hatred. You know, about 60 years ago, a modern nation with Christian churches all around, a nation where the Reformation was born, that nation fell into the satanic trap of ignoring the needy and blaming the victims. Pastor Martin Niemöller wrote about that dark time, and I quote from him, and he said, "In Germany, they came first for the communists, and I did not speak up because I was not a communist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak up because I was not a Jew. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak up because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Catholics, and I did not speak up because I was not a Catholic. And then they came for me." And by that time, no one was left to speak up. The words of Pastor Martin Niemöller. Yes, in Germany, the Christians, with a few exceptions, I admit, but most of the Christians were silent about the Nazi horrors. They were much like the priest and the Levite in Jesus' parable. They walked by while the wounded and hurt were in need. And because of that, evil ran rampant because Satan's scheme of ignoring the needy and blaming the victims was adopted by so many people. Jesus really hammers the religious legal experts of his day. The Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees, he usually calls them corrupt. Remember, Jesus in this parable is answering the questions of a religious legal expert. He's answering the questions of a man who wants to find a loophole out of his duty to show love. But Jesus does not just quit here. He doesn't leave us with a parable with just two evil villains and no heroes. Jesus tells us that a Samaritan came along. Now, in modern times, the word Samaritan has really come to mean someone who is helpful, loving, and giving. But that's not the original meaning the word had. To the people who lived in Jesus' day, the word Samaritan had a really different meaning. They had a stereotype of Samaritans, and they saw them as perverted, evil, dirty, nasty, and unclean. To the Jews, the Samaritans were the rejects of the world who could never do anything right. The Samaritans were really hated. Now, I have tried and tried to find a comparable word for today that would give us the same kind of thoughts and images that a first century Jew would have had about a Samaritan. I believe I may have found the right word. I believe that the word sleazeball may carry the same weight for us today. So Jesus says that this sleazeball comes along and he's the hero. The sleazeball has pity on the wounded man and renders him aid. The wounded man is given first aid, then transported to the nearest safe place, and is well taken care of. Notice how the Samaritan, the man, the hero, uses his own animal to transport the wounded man to safety. The Samaritan then pays for the wounded man's care with his own money, 2 denarii, and each denarii was the typical daily wage, so he's paying 2 days of wages. And the Samaritan has also altered his time, changed his plans, and spent additional money by promising to come back to the inn and pay the innkeeper whatever other expenses the wounded man might have. I'm really shocked. That is amazing what he does, especially considering the irony of who Jesus picks out to be the hero in the story. Not the religious guys, but the reject, the sleazeball, is the hero. And that's an example of how we should live. For God has told us that true religion is in helping others. In James 1:27, we read, "Religion that is pure and undefiled before the Father is this, to care for widows and orphans in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world." That's James 1:27. The Samaritan demonstrated love and true character when he got down into the ditch and helped the person in need. That is what we all should be doing as Christians. So after telling the parable, Jesus asked the religious legal expert, "Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The religious legal expert hates the Samaritan so much that you notice he doesn't even say the name Samaritan. He says, the one who showed him mercy. Jesus tells him to go and do likewise. That's a real harsh statement because the man wouldn't even say Samaritan. And Jesus says, act like the Samaritan. And we as Jesus followers must get down into the ditch and help those who need help. That is how we must show that we are true followers of and true believers in Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord. A Christian businessman, he knew how to be a Samaritan. On his first trip to a third world country, he was astounded by the poverty. On his next trip, he stuffed all of his shoes, extra shoes, into his suitcase. His wife was kind of surprised, but he told his wife, "Shoes are a rare commodity in that poor country, and I'm going to give away as many shoes as I can." When he returned home, his wife met him at the airport. As he walked off the plane, she noticed that he was barefoot. He was a true Christian. We all should hold the needy and the poor in the highest regard, just as Jesus did. For Jesus has very strong words for those who hate, mistreat, or ignore the needy or the poor. Jesus tells us in Matthew 25, verses 41 through 45, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they will also answer, "Lord, when was it we saw you hungry, or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And they will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The Samaritan demonstrated that he was willing to get down into the ditch and give aid to the needy. He demonstrated love and mercy. He showed the behaviors that bear witness to true faith in Jesus Christ. Are you willing? Are you willing to get into the ditches of our lives and assist the needy people in love, compassion, and mercy? Because that's what Jesus commands. I'd like to thank you very much for tuning into Radio Good News here on 1140 KSOO. If you have any questions or any ideas you want to share with me, please write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota 57101. Hey, thanks again for tuning in. Now, I'm heading out to be in the fellowship of other believers in a Christian worship service. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship and be encouraged and find out how to aid and help the needy. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches of various denominations. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. And always remember, love the Lord your God with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind, and love your neighbors as yourselves. We'll finish off the program with some contemporary Christian music from Kim Boyce.
Somebody's down to their last dime. Somebody's running out of time. Not too far from here. Somebody's got nowhere else to go. Somebody needs a little hope. Not too far from here. And I may not know that. But I'm praying just the same that you'll use me, Lord, to wipe away a tear. 'Cause somebody's crying not too far from here. Somebody's troubled and confused. Somebody's got nothing. Somebody's forgotten how to trust. Somebody's dying for love. Not too far from here. It may be a stranger's face, but I'm praying for.